Indian Space Agency successfully launched the Chandrayaan 2 satellite into the Earth orbit. It gave a little heartburn to ISRO, but after that, it was a more than textbook launch of the geosynchronous satellite launch vehicle, or the Bahubali, which I call often. I have with me the man of the moment, Dr. K. Sivan, the chairman of ISRO, a rocket man par excellence, the man who tamed the naughty boy of ISRO. Dr. Sivan, what was your feeling when the geosynchronous satellite launch vehicle lifted off that afternoon?
It was really exciting moment. Before the launch, we are sure that this will be a success. The reason is we had undergone one rehearsal or one trial 1 week back. The entire the liquid stage got filled up initially, then along with that even up to cryogenic stage got filled up halfway through. So except the technical snag, what we discovered at one hour before launch, all other systems functioned very well. And once we have fixed the technical snag, we know that this is going to be very successful. And
when you went into the control room on the afternoon of July 22nd, what was going in your mind? Because you had had an issue earlier.
It is really the problem, the same thing only I had on that day. Before that, the beginning of the day, morning, we were very confident and no issue. And as time goes near to the launch time, then slowly our tension started increasing. And when after igniting the thing, still the anxiety will go. This is the usual characteristics of a launch phase. That also we had that one.
So how did you tell your people who were there in your mission control center not to lose cool?
Basically, that what I did was that the previous day, after reaching the Sicilian quota, the first thing I did was I met all the team members who have really worked for last 1 week, and really they toiled and they really struggled to make the sure that the systems are all right. These particular people I met and I gave confidence to them. What they have done is good and they are right. They need not worry. They can be confident that they can achieve the success of this mission on that day. So that way, once I talked to them for 1 hour, their morale got boosted, and they become the real engineers, ISRO engineer, and they really achieved.
See, we launched from the Satish Dhawan Space Center, and we are doing this interview right under the benevolent eye of Vikram Sarabhai. Do you think Vikram Sarabhai would have been happy the way you fixed and went on with the launch?
This is a lesson we learned from Vikram Sarabhai only. This is a culture that created by Dr. Vikram Sarabhai that we are simply following. And definitely, if he was there, he would have been very, very happy the way we worked on that day.
So what happened during the time when the mission was aborted?
And when the mission was aborted, at that time it is a very, very hard decision, very unfamiliar or unfamous decision we have to take it. And but by knowing the system performance, we have to have not only just by seeing the parameters, we have to judge what will happen after 1 hour, what will happen the system when it is really the system got ignited and going. And this kind of that judgment is required, and a very hard decision. And also, you know, the Honorable the President was sitting there, and then how it is like a balance between technical And at the same time, we had to ensure that the emotional space also. It's a very difficult situation, the decision, but we had taken. But after seeing the significant snag, what I say is, the decision we had taken was right decision.
What was the technical snag? What went wrong and how did you fix it?
There is the pressure in one of the systems got reduced. Usually, you know that the rocket system is function with a very high pressure, like a 200 bar, 300 bar. Also, they'll be working with a high temperature, like 3,000 Kelvin, 3,500 Kelvin, like this. So when we have such type of the system, we always look for ensuring the system performance at the high extreme environment should function properly. And what we have seen is in one of the systems got leaked with the high pressure. That we fixed that problem.
So what would have, whatever was happening at Thumba at that point, was the pressure on you as high or as low at that point when you were taking that decision?
Definitely, this taking the decision at this harsh environment is not new to ISRO. ISRO has done many times this type of decisions. So that way, that we have that the experience or the culture or that the way we are functioning. And not only we are there, and our seniors who had veterans in this area also was participated. That way, taking a decision is not a very difficult job for us.
But with the president there just one step away from the mission control center, was there pressure on you to lift it off that way, launch it that day?
There is absolutely no pressure. And in fact, the presence of the Honorable President was not felt to the downstream of any of the people. So that way, they're extremely helpful, the president office, and they really that they ensure that none of our activities are affected. And when I met and told president about the problem, he smilingly said, please go ahead with our activities. Technical activities more important than my presence, please go ahead. So that gave a confidence for me to go ahead for the decisions and activities.
He didn't scold you, Sivan, what have you done? I have come all the way to Sriharikota and you're not launching.
No, in fact, he praised me for the decision we have taken. I would say that it's a great bonus for us when he praised me. Either you are taking the right decision, a technical decision to hold the launch, please go ahead. That gave a real boost for our morale.
So when you take a decision like that, do you think that if we had launched on July 15th midnight, what would have resulted? Would it have resulted in a failure or would it have gone ahead? What was the risk factor involved?
So what I would say that I won't say that failure or success. The situation there was not conducive for launch. You can understand which way to take, I'm leaving to you. But it is not conducive for launch. Yes, we know there are certain parameters should be within certain thing, then only we can have a launch. It is not comfortable for us to go ahead.
So it was a right decision to take.
I'm sure that 100% sure that the way the system performance subsequently, and when we, after that next 24 hours, the people there working continuously and brought the vehicle back to normal, and they went and checked the system, and after checking the system, we realized that we had taken 100% right decision to hold the launch.
And what happened in the first 24 hours and in the next 24 hours? Because you said in your post-launch that you were able to fix the problem in 48 hours.
See, basically, next 24 hours, continuously the ISRO team, not only engineers, the technicians, technical assistant, supporting staff, they worked non-stop mode to bring the vehicle to the normal conditions, first of all, because the vehicle was filled with liquid propellants in the L110 stage, as well as the half-filled conditions for the cryogenic stage. And we have to drain the propellant. We have to save the vehicle. And from all the conditions, that took some time. Then after that, we had to bring back the supporting structures of the vehicle for the people to work in. Then people are climbed in to the vehicle and looked where this anomaly, and they understood what really how the anomaly happened. And then they understood and realized and implemented what the corrective measures. All this is happening within 24 hours.
It's not easy.
It is not easy, but there is ISRO. And the people, once that job is given, they won't sleep until they complete the task. And remember, this is not only one person working. The entire team ISRO, the entire Srihariko range, the members, there's engineers, technician, technical assistant, supporting staff. Most of the engineers required from that launch vehicle side, Vikram Space Center, Liquid Propulsion System Center, then IPRC. And in fact, you just imagine at 1 o'clock, 1:30, this particular anomaly was identified. At 1:30, we made a call to that IPRC engineers who are sleeping in the house and asked them to come by this one. And within 1 hour, they started from the IPRC by vehicle. They started from the vehicle from the Vikram Space Center. And by that time, the vehicle was brought to normal. The team from other centers were readily available for fixing the snag. So it is like working in a continuous mode, but not the tangential, not the longitudinal wise, work zigzag mode, so that when your task is completed, other team is getting ready to do the next job. And when that job is ready, yet another job team will be ready to do the job. This is the type of culture we created in ISRO that was worked out on that day. That way we could fix the whole problem very short time, even less than whatever I expected time. And some people did not believe that we could do it, but we did it. Not we, our teammates did it.
So in 48 hours, you were sure you could launch it?
Yes, after 24 hours itself, we understood. Once the technical snag was identified, and also the solution also was identified, immediately, we know that when we can have the launch.
So then why did you take about a week to come back for the launch?
That is because even though the technical snag is fixed, now we have to check whether whatever solution we adopted is right or not. And we need to check the system. And also we need to, not only that one, this particular anomaly happened in the pre-countdown. It's happened during countdown. That is, so in the service condition. So we wanted to recreate the service conditions. And under those conditions, we want to ensure that the systems are intact. So that for that, we took another 1.5 days, this one. And after fixing the thing and completing every job, now we had to bring back the vehicle to normal conditions. That is, we had to say essential checks we had to do on the vehicle to ensure that the systems are not got disturbed. Because when we are fixing the signal sag, whether unknowingly any other system got affected. This type of thing, we wanted to ensure that everything is right. And this takes certain time. And that, considering everything only, that without losing any time, we have fixed that launch time on 22nd.
So would you say this was part of the unknowns which come about when you do rocketry?
You are told exactly correct. This is the one exactly I used to tell. In rocket, there are unknown unknowns. We have flown 2 times earlier, but still something we have to learn. And this is exactly the one typical example of unknown unknowns.
So what is the lesson you learned in this? Because every time there has been a failure, this was not a failure, this was only a setback. In this, what was the big lesson you learned?
That is how a cryogenic stage system in the low temperature, the structure, the joint, the gas, the circuits, how it will behave. This particular system we learned in this particular the trial, this one.
Cryogenics has been giving you trouble from the very beginning. First the Russians and Americans gave you trouble, and now the engines itself are giving you some trouble.
Sir, it's not cryogenics alone. It's the rocket systems are like that. Because we call rocket science. Because we are working on extremes. And we are working on the three-digit number pressures. And we are working on the four-digit numbers temperatures. And on these extremes when you are working, this type of system is working. It is not because of cryogenics or solid motor or liquid engine. Any system, any time, any problem will come. It is nothing to do with a particular system.
You are known as India's rocket man. And this is the geosynchronous satellite launch vehicle Mark II, a model of this. You had back-to-back failures, and at that point, you were tasked to bring this vehicle back onto the launch pad, and you had described it as ISRO's naughty boy. What went through your mind, and how did you fix the problem with the geosynchronous satellite launch vehicle Mark II?
See, basically, when that GSLV, when I took over, that unfortunately it had some multiple failures in a different system. And what I did was, what we did was that we have gone through the entire vehicle design once again and got through that design margins, and also say gone through that earlier flight data, and everywhere the design margins and improvements were incorporated. And especially this the cryogenic stage, and we got some 700 milliseconds of data. This data were analyzed. We put through a big team, and they brought out the total the issues of this one, and we got through a detailed test program, and we just when we have flown, successfully we have good it.
So how difficult was it to tame this naughty boy?
It was not a difficult job because this is we did the entire the design verifications once again. Whatever happened for that 15 years, we repeated the whole exercise in a very short time. That way, it is a complex task, but we did it because ISRO is a team. He is always happy to do the complex task.
Well. Now we are in front of the geosynchronous satellite launch vehicle Mark III, which sometimes I call the Bahubali, the rocket which lifted Chandrayaan 2 up into the Earth orbit. This, the world says, is a very elegant vehicle. What gives Mark III this elegance, and why is it such a good and powerful long-term vehicle for India?
See, basically, the vehicle is a very simple, or is a more robust. If your number of operations on the flight we are reducing. If you have seen this vehicle, the two solid motors.
Yeah, the two on the side.
Yeah. They are ignited on the ground itself.
Yeah.
And that in flight, only two ignitions happening. This is the liquid engine, L110 engine, as well as cryogenic engine.
Yes.
Only two ignitions happening. And two separations.
Yes.
Very simple thing, a simple system, more reliable, and that way we got this one. Now also another one was this particular cryogenic system, we developed on our own by India. When we are developing the whole system on our own, we had full handle. That way, we have the full confidence that this very simple vehicle and reliable vehicle. And that's the reason we're able to improve the performance of the vehicle more and more, this one.
Yeah, you brought it 15% higher performance for this particular launch of Chandrayaan 2. How did you manage to give it better performance?
No, that is, we know that everywhere there is the margins are available. Like, for example, this 1110 engine is working with one particular the thrust level, pressure level. We found that if you are increasing the thrust level, we can gain some payload. That is the way. Then like the cryogenics engine also, that is the engine that is, the thrust level was slightly increased. And similarly, some of the structures, mass were reduced margin. Understanding the how much margins are available and that without losing its requirement, we are able to bring back the payload performance of the vehicle. Now, I would say that this vehicle is able to, capable of launching 4 ton, for which the vehicle was designed for.
Correct. Now, you, I presume you placed the Chandrayaan 2 satellite somewhere here in this top part of the vehicle. This is a model, but this is where you placed it? Just behind where the flag and the Ashok Chakra is?
Yes, yes. This is this portion is called, the top portion is called, the white portion, that is called the payload fairing. And the Chandrayaan 2, along with combination of that orbiter, lander and rover, they're kept on inside the portion.
We'll come to the lander and rover a little bit. Let me, when we have the flag and the Ashok Chakra, when you go and land on the moon, we'll talk about that a little later. Are you are planning to put the ISRO logo and the Ashok Chakra on the lunar surface?
Yes. Right now our plan is that in the rover wheel, that every, both sides we have three wheels. And in the back wheel, we put in one side the Ashok Chakra, and another side we put the ISRO emblem. So that wherever this rover is moving, Indian emblem is there along with the ISRO emblem. Also, in the ramp of the
lander
for make it the rover to come out, there we are putting the Indian flag also. So Indian flag will be positioned in moon forever.
And we don't bring these back. They will remain on the moon forever.
They are going to be there only. Probably, maybe in the much later, if you are going there, as I think we may bring back. We do not know.
you have plans of setting a colony, so you could bring them back. They would be great artifacts.
Correct. But it will be there. But our symbol will be always there.
Now, this particular launcher, the geosynchronous satellite launch vehicle Mark 3, when it sent Chandrayaan 2 into orbit, it gave you a very good performance. Chandrayaan 2 is in the Earth orbit. Tell us a little bit about what happened. How did you get a good orbit?
See, this particular mission, first of all, this the mass of the vehicle, the Chandrayaan 2, was more than the capacity of the vehicle as is to start with. So we wanted to carry the Chandrayaan 2, which is more than the capacity of the vehicle initially. So what we did was, to ensure that it is happening, we increased the performance of the subsystems of the vehicle. That way, one way is increased. Another one is, we made the cryogenic stage to take it, all the benefits from that by burn to depletion. Earlier, we used to make the system such that once the orbital conditions are achieved, we are like a GTO. GTO means that the apogee orbit altitude is fixed. So once it has reached that conditions, the guidance will be cut off. But whereas here, apogee is not fixed. Still, we have to go further.
Yes, yes, yes.
So maximum getting from the vehicle is always beneficial. So we told that you make it burn to depletion. And the process, we made it, the mission planning was done like this. Very interestingly, by this process, we thought that in the normal conditions, it is reaching the apogee of only, that is, 39,000 kilometer orbit. But very nicely, the vehicle has gone, pull the push and push, and we got the orbit of 45,000 kilometer orbit.
So that means you've been able to save fuel for the orbiter by getting this?
Yes, definitely. This will be as a beneficial for the orbiter, for as a bonus.
So meaning at some point, if we don't deplete it while going to the moon, we may have an increased life of the orbiter.
Yes, yes, definitely. That is this will be useful as for increasing the orbiter life, or maybe it may be useful for doing some other experiment also. That we will decide later.
See, what happened when the launch was, that was the first step. Beyond that, you have many other tricky steps with Chandrayaan 2. You've called it the most complex mission ISRO has ever undertaken. Tell us about the next steps which are going to happen. How will you increase it in the Earth orbit, and what will happen later?
See, this Jesli Marti launched the satellite with the apogee distance of, that is, 45,000 kilometer orbit. But you know, the distance between Earth to Moon is 384,000 kilometer distance. So to reach that particular portion, instead of going as a single step to that 384,000 kilometer orbit, we are going in a step-by-step mode. In that process, we will be gaining some, or we are reducing the loss of performance. So that way we'll go step by step, some maneuvers. And finally, at one day, we'll be going at a single shot to Moon, which is taking the spacecraft to the Moon height. And there also, again, number of maneuvers will be done to bring the vehicle, the Chandrayaan, to
the composite body.
Composite body, about around the Moon. Then again, it has reduced the orbit size. All this require the complex maneuvers. This is what I called. Every maneuver is like every launch. So it's a very, very complex system, because we have to plan, because we have to execute. And at that time, after that, we have to execution, we have to bring the system back to normal. Then after a few days, again, once again, we have to switch on the system. They again execute. So this is a big process. So that's what I told, it's a very complex mission.
And the orbiter is in space. It's not like you had it on the launch pad where you can get to the rocket and fix it. So now you will have no opportunity. Everything has to work according to plan.
Absolutely right. You are right. That is, everything should work. We are not having any opportunity. It has to work on its own. And that's what now, today we are enjoying. And maybe day by day, our tension will again increase as a function of time till our landing.
Now, tell me a little bit about the landing. See, till the stage we put the composite body in the lunar orbit, we have experience from Chandrayaan 1. But beyond that, when you send the lander down, what will happen at that point?
Yes, that's what is the crucial part of the entire mission is that. The orbiter will put the composite body in 100 by 100 kilometer orbit. From that, the orbiter will be separated from the lander. Now lander is on its own. First, we'll make the lander's orbit from 100 by 100 circular to 100 by 30. We have a retro maneuver, de-boost maneuver, to ensure, to check all the systems of the lander is functioned properly, that we have a 4-day chance to see everything is right. After that only, once you are ensuring that everything is right, now the real landing maneuver will start. Once the maneuver is started for landing from the 30 kilometer, it is landing on the surface of the Moon, it takes 15 minutes. This 15 minutes travel of lander is new to ISRO. The first time we are going to some another body, and there's no atmosphere, And we are going to make use of the propulsion system to break the velocity and bring the vehicle safely to soft land.
See, you're orbiting the moon, which is at very high velocity. I'm told about 36,000 kilometers per hour. And then you have to bring it to almost zero in 15 minutes. Is that correct?
No, the 36 kilometers per hour is not that. The thing it's small, but it's very high velocity. We have to bring it to zero, this one. And when you are...
And all of that will happen in 15 minutes?
Yes. This is when you are bringing the velocity to zero, what happens is, if you are leaving the vehicle, it will fall like a football. And at the same time, if you are not allowing to break the thing, the thrust is accurate, it won't come down also. It is a balance between the gravity and the thrust. So the thrust of the engine will be modulated in a required condition such that it is breaking the velocity, but at the same time, it is not falling under the gravity and landing with zero velocity. All three things should happen simultaneously. That is the beauty of this one. And this is the first time we are doing for us this thing. And very interestingly, this when you are seeing the history of these missions, that is, whatever the missions planned for Chandrayaan landing mission.
Soft landing mission.
Nearly the success rate is only 37.5%. Because it's not that I am telling, it is not to threaten you, it is to tell that how complex this process is. So that's what we are telling, that this is a very, very complex process and is new to us. Now, even for the people who are already done, every time it will be a complex process. And here we are doing first time, so that's what we told that is 15 minutes of terror for us, this will be.
So when the lander comes down, what happens next? Once suppose it is on the lunar surface, what would be the next step?
Now, after lander is landed on the soft landed on the moon, then what you do is there is the rover, we have to take it out. So it will be the ram will come out and it will be landing on the surface of the moon. And from that inside, then that rover will come out from the inside, rolling out, and it will come out, this one. The whole process will take about, I think, the 4 hours, this one.
Dust could interfere with your payloads?
Yes, that is a dust, lunar dust is one major concern. And that's what we have seen that different combinations of the propulsion system, because when the propulsion system is functioning, it has to function till end, otherwise it will fall. It is like propulsion system will be equal to sustaining the vehicle. When it is coming there, it is holding, just like we are holding a baby and bringing it down. That holding activity function is done by the propulsion system. And we have the combination of 4 engines at the corner to bring down the Chandrayaan 2. But if the 4 engines are coming together, it may create a confusion. It is like a troubled water, like that you can create a lot of dust. For that only, at certain altitude, this engine will be switched off, and we introduce a central engine. So only one engine will be there. One engine is burning. When it is coming near land, the surface, the dust will fly horizontally. So it won't come up. So that is our prediction. And that's what these are the corrections we have done that last 1.5 years. That's what a lot of modifications we have done in the Chandrayaan 1 to take care of this type of issues.
So you named the lander Vikram. This is Vikram Sarabhai's centenary year. So it will be essentially like Vikram Sarabhai slowly lowering India's flag and India's rover onto the lunar surface, like a father bringing the baby down onto the lunar surface?
Maybe sentimentally you can tell like that.
But this is a tricky operation.
Yes, definitely it's tricky. That's what I told you. It is like suddenly somebody has come and give a newborn baby to your hand, whether you'll be able to hold it. without the proper support. That the body with the baby will that move this way, that way, but we should hold it. It's like that. The lander will go with this and all, but at the same time, it should be brought just like a baby. That's what is done by this the propulsion system and sensor system, actuation system, the software system, everything will work together as a single system to ensure that it is happening safely without any problem.
And what is the science we will do with Chandrayaan 2?
There are a lot of science we are expecting. We are expecting the mineralogy of that one. Then we will be doing that as the topology, then rock forming element science, and also in situ experiments of the chemical composition of the surface of the Earth.
Are we looking for water on the moon?
Water also one of the science we are looking for.
Because Chandrayaan 1 brought the first signs of presence of water molecules. So continuation with Chandrayaan 2 with the dual band radar searching for water?
That is already there. It is one of the payloads we are working on that.
So far excited about Chandrayaan?
Definitely it's a exciting moment, and it's going to create further excitement. As day progress, I'm sure that we'll be having a lot of excitement for the Chandrayaan 2 mission. So it's a new lesson for us.
Chandrayaan 2 is already ongoing towards the moon. There is an ongoing mission of yours, which is Gaganyaan, which Prime Minister Narendra Modi said you have to fulfill by the 75th year of India's independence. How is your preparation going for Gaganyaan, which is to put an Indian astronaut in space?
Now, Gaganyaan program, that is, it is already the design phase is completed. Now, realization phase is started. That is one part. And also, there is we have already identified the process for selecting that astronaut. That process is also going on. And also, we identified that places where that the training for the astronauts is going to be there. That is the one. And also, we are getting ready for the pad abort test configurations at the earliest. And also, that is the engine test for human rating. That portion also going on. And next that 6 to 7 months, that the continuously this work will be, the testing will be there. And so we are planning to have our first unmanned mission by end of next year.
So here we see that very beautiful picture where the satellite was carried on a bullock cart. And here we are talking about Gaganyaan, which is sending an Indian into space. How big a leap is it for India, and how has ISRO progressed?
It really is the technological leap we have at ISRO has achieved. It's because of the teamwork, and that makes every Indian proud. And I'm sure that the Chandrayaan 2 is going to make every Indian proud, because it is going to create a new science. And as you'd have seen that one very nicely that NASA of they congratulated yesterday to us. They're telling that the place where we are going to land, you are going to see
the new
science will come.
Yes.
So you please give the science. It's a good thing. So this is a way this is a good way of telling. And we are going to create a new science.
But ISRO is not less than NASA. Why do we have to look over the shoulder to NASA?
No, I'm just telling, if somebody's praising, it's always good, isn't it? That is the PSR praising, PSR telling, they can talk in equal language. That will be the right language.
See, Moon is one mission, Gaganyaan you spoke. You also have, from Moon, looking at the Sun beyond this. Tell us a little bit about your mission to the Sun.
Now, we are going to have a mission that is the Aditya L1 mission. That we are going to have. This is to study that the sun's corona, the behavior. And this mission we are going to plan for next year, first half, this one. And this also another mission is going to give exciting mission. It's going to be there for the scientists.
So essentially exciting times for ISRO?
Yes. See, definitely that we are going to have that uh, the for the science people, that Chandrayaan, then Aditya L1, then we are going ExpoSat, then we have that the next missions like Venus mission, Mars orbiter mission, next version, like that for science people is there. At the same time, that is, we are having that our conventional that applications missions like remote sensing, communications, navigation, that is their own part. Another part what you are talking about is that is that mainly that the applications, how we are going to make applications of this mission, this one. At the same time, we have to improve the performance of the applications, whatever we are giving. Like that the government of India's the Digital India program, how we can improve our system, that like that, how our satellite is going to give input for improving the Digital India program, like that. Also, we wanted to go to the place where the provide the broadband, the wide the broadband link to that the places where we are that are not gone. Like that, many exciting programs are there, and I'm sure that we'll achieve all those things.
I wish you luck in that. Just to conclude, let me tell our viewers, this is where India's space program roughly started, using a bullock cart to transport a satellite. It was done for reasons of scientific reasons, not because we lacked the resources. Initially, rockets were carried on cycle. This happened at Thumba. Beyond that, Chandrayaan 2 uses the Bahubali rocket, which can now put 4 tons into space. Beyond that, India has plans to send Indian astronauts into space. And deep space is India's way forward. So ISRO contributing both for India's national development and contributing for planetary exploration. Touching lives, saving lives is a hallmark of ISRO. And Dr. Sivan says they will continue to deliver good quality science and good quality missions for India. With camera person Kumar in Bangalore, Pallava Bagla for NDTV.